fly fishing flies, tying your own. For many fly fishermen, the joy of angling is only surpassed by mastering the art of tying their own flies. Each carefully crafted lure makes a statement and expresses something of the artist's creativity, embodying his hopes and desires to attract those beautiful fish to his line. This art can be a time-consuming process, even tedious, but ultimately rewarding when you experience your first successful catch with one of your own flies. In this chapter, you'll be learning some of the basic techniques involved in tying your own flies, moving step by step through the process. We'll want to spend some time learning a little about the various implements used in the tying process, as well as looking at some of the more common materials that are used in the construction of flies. Tools. Having the right kind of tools is as important as having the materials for tying flies themselves. Without the proper equipment, you can actually make your tying sessions more difficult than they really need to be. What follows is a list of essential fly tying tools. We will be covering each item briefly and noting its common usage during fly tying. Scissors. For most fly tying, you will need a good solid pair of scissors with micro serrated blades. To aid ease of cutting, it is recommended to have a big hole type. The tying materials are less likely to slide out of them while cutting. Bobbin. This is a tool you use to hold the tying thread. With it, you can control the tension on the thread as you tie. After it is released, the thread will not slide through the bobbin. Bodkin. This is a type of needle set in the handle and used for picking out fur or other dubbing to create a pointy or jagged look. Other purposes may include the application of head cement or making adjustments to the thread and materials. Dubbing comb. Serving two purposes, the dubbing comb can be used to comb the underfur from deer or elk hair, so you are left with the long, hollow hairs used in many of the wings and tails of flies. Also, the dubbing comb can be used to search the underfur from animal skins, for example muskrat or hare, to find the fine, fuzzy underfur that will be used as dubbing. Hackle pliers. Generally used for gripping the hackle, these specialized pliers allow you to wrap the hackle onto the hook with a fair degree of control. They make a good alternative to using your fingers because they allow for much finer control. Hair stacker. This is a tool that you use to apply different kinds of animal hair onto your flies. It is used by inserting the hair into a tube, pointed down, and then tapped onto a table. The result is a more even look to the pointed parts of the hair. Whip finisher. This is the finalizing tool. Taking its name from the final knot made to finish up a fly, the whip finisher is supposed to make it an easier task. Fly tying materials. Now that we have introduced the tools you will be using, the next step will be to discuss the vast selection of materials that are used by fly fishermen to create beautiful and elaborately contrived flies. This is by no means meant to represent every material option available to the creative fly fisherman. There are always new and different ways to build flies from the ground up. The materials listed here are provided for beginners who want to experiment with tying the simple flies before they move on to more complicated arrangements. It is important to start by mentioning three very specific items. These items will be recurring elements each time you decide to tie another fly, so you should keep them in good supply. Topping this short list, you have the hook, followed by dubbing wax and head cement. Material basics. Hooks. The hook is one of the more important ingredients. No one is likely to dispute this. Now, when it comes to the hooks that are used in fly tying, you will find just as much variety in both shape and size as you would with any standard fishing hooks. In order to brush up on hook basics, let's begin with some of the common characteristics of every hook, regardless of type. Each part comes together to create the standard hook design. Shank. This is the straight part of the hook that stretches from just behind the eye all the way to the beginning of the bend. The bulk of the fly will be built off of this portion. Bend. This is the part of the hook that is curved. With certain hooks, the bend is more pronounced than others due to the length of its curvature. This has led to a standard definition for the bend's locations, which is the area from directly above the barb to the eye. Gape or gap. This is defined as the width of the opening or gap between the hook's point and the shank. Different widths may be used specifically for different types of fish or in making different kinds of lures. Eye. Although this part of the hook should be self-explanatory, it doesn't hurt to mention it. This is, of course, where any lines will be attached once your fly has been tied. Hook proportions are normally constant despite being made by different manufacturers. There are three top brands of fly tying hooks currently on the market: Diemco, Mustad, and Daiichi. Of the three, Mustad is considered the standard hook to use. When you are comparing one brand against another, you may find there are differences between the classifications and model numbers. Dubbing wax. This wax will come in handy by allowing you to apply dubbing to the fly thread. When applied to the fingers, this wax acts as a slight adhesive that makes the material stick to the skin for ease of application. Many veteran fly tiers use just water in a similar capacity. Head cement. This thin liquid cement is primarily used to secure the whip finish knot after the fly has been completed. You simply apply a small amount to the knot to help prevent it from slipping. Natural materials. Hackle. One of the more popularly used materials, hackle is really just rooster feathers. But not just any feathers. Hackle is made from the ones found around the neck area. The reason they are used in fly tying is that they're small and stiff and can be found in many colors, so they can be used for a variety of flies. Due to this firm consistency, rooster feathers are typically used for hackle on dry flies. It is also worth mentioning that hen feathers serve a similar purpose on wet flies. When you're using hackle to tie flies, it is important to measure the hackle against the size of the fly you plan to tie, so you will have plenty of material. Sizing hackle is a fairly easy matter, but there is a way to make it easier. Some fly fishermen employ the use of an instrument known as a hackle gauge. This simple device allows for more accurate measuring. Besides those used in hackle, a number of different bird feathers are used to make fly ties. The list is only representative of more commonly used elements, but there are always new combinations and new bird feathers that are finding use by some enterprising fly fisherman who gets pleasure from tying his own flies. Goose quills are used for wings on dry and wet flies alike and can also be used for wing cases and nymphs. Pheasant tail. The tail feathers of pheasants are used for the legs, bodies, and wing cases in nymphs, as well as several other kinds of flies. They form the main element of the pheasant tail nymph, but have been used in other flies as knotted hopper legs. Plus, they have found further usage in other nymphs. Marabou. These small but fluffy feathers find great usage in woolly buggers and streamers because of their flowing consistency in the water. Mallard flanks. Also called cul de canard, these specialized feathers are taken from the rumps of ducks. The feathers are small and have natural buoyancy due to their proximity to oil glands in the bird's skin. Uses for mallard flanks can vary, but it should be noted that they make excellent wings on dry flies, yet they've been known to be used for making nymph legs and other fly tails. Most fly tiers prefer the feather in its natural color rather than dyed. Peacock curl. This brilliantly plumed feather has shimmering, iridescent qualities that have made it one of the favorite naturally occurring fly tying materials. Turkey tail. These feathers are used for a lot of the same fly components as the pheasant tail. Also, like goose feathers, turkey feathers are used to make the wings and wing cases of many flies. Biot. It is the fiber-like portion of wing feathers and is used for making segmented fly bodies, antennae, and even tails. Turkey and goose biots are commonly used, but some fly fishermen use other types. In the case of some fly designs, very exotic kinds of feathers are favored to create a colorful element that will be very attractive to the fish they are trying to catch. When obtaining such feathers proves difficult or even cost prohibitive, one very creative alternative is to substitute one of the more commonly used feathers, even going as far as to take these commonplace varieties and dye them to resemble the desired exotic feather. Animal hair. The different types of animal hair that can be used in fly tying are almost too numerous to list. But to give you some idea of what types are in use among many fly tying anglers, it is good to mention a couple of key examples. Deer hair. This fine hair is used for making wings on hare wings and small caddis. However, these are just a couple of choices. Fly tiers have come up with many innovations in their personal fly designs that incorporate this animal fur. Elk hair. Like deer hair, elk serves a similar purpose in fly construction, finding use as swings on flies. Both kinds of animal hair have a great characteristic that makes them a plus. They are hollow, so they will float. Artificial or synthetic materials. When it comes to designing a great fly, it usually comes down to a careful synthesis of both natural and artificial materials in order to create the desired look and hopefully end up with an attractive fly. The list of synthetic elements is typically larger than that of natural materials, simply because they may be easier to come by in some stores. A list of different artificial materials has been included to show you what is out there and what sort of use they may be to your personal fly tying experiments. Beads. Beads find popular use as the head of some flies. In most cases, you will want to find beads that will fit your fly hook by matching the sizes. Antron yarn. A synthetic material, commonly known as Zelon, has a unique feature. The structure of the material traps air bubbles from time to time, which lends the fly more realistic or lifelike appearance. Chenille. Chenille is a soft, strung material that is used to form bodies on many flies by being wrapped around the hooks. It comes in a couple of sizes, medium and ultra. Medium chenille is used to tie the woolly bugger fly as well as several other large flies, while the thinner, ultra chenille finds more use for wrapping smaller fly bodies. This material can be found in a variety of colors as well, including brown, black, olive, yellow, chartreuse, red, and burnt orange. Foam. Because of its buoyant qualities, foam is used by many fly tiers for cut wings and floating bodies in some of their flies. You must be careful when using foam, though, because if it's wrapped too tight, you may collapse some of the pockets inside, causing the material to lose some or even all of its buoyancy. Crystal Flash. If you want something that adds some sparkle or shine to your flies in order to attract fish, you will probably want to buy some Crystal Flash. Made from mylar, the material can be tied in at various points of the fly, so you will have plenty to draw fish to. Start with a pearl color and expand from there. Thread. This is probably the most important material you will need. Though it hardly needs explanation, thread is the glue that holds everything else together. You use it to tie the materials onto the hook. Different types of thread are available for different fly types. Wire. Wire is used for applying ribbing to certain flies. Types of fly fishing knots. Although there are many different knots used by anglers, there are limited numbers of proven basic knots. The following knots cover most requirements, from attaching your backing to the spool or arbor of your reel, attaching leaders to line, fly to leader, and tying your own leaders. For the benefit of beginners, short instructions for tying some of these basic knots have been included as well. Most knots can be accomplished in as little as 3 to 5 easy steps, depending upon the knot you're working with. Our first knot, the arbor knot, is used to attach line to the reel spool, simply and easily. This is probably one of the better knots for beginners to start working with, as you'll be using it time and time again throughout your fly fishing experiences. Take a look at the following steps to tie the arbor knot. You will want to start by passing the fly line around the reel's arbor. Next, tie an overhanded knot around the line. After you have the first knot in place, then add a second overhanded knot at the tag end. Finally, you will want to pull this tight and use scissors to trim off the excess. Be sure that you tighten your first knot on the reel's arbor. From the basic arbor knot, we will move on to one of the bigger knots around. It is probably one of the strongest knots you can use for binding together two different lines, regardless of diameter. I'm talking about the blood knot. Let's see how to tie one of these hardy blood knots. It may make quite a difference when we need more line, but have only two different lines with us. As before, this knot has a number of steps to be followed. You're going to start this knot by overlapping the two chosen lines. Be sure to allow yourself some slack, no less than 6 inches. Once you're sure you have enough, go ahead and take one of the lines and wrap it around the other at least 5 times. After the lines are securely wrapped, you will want to take hold of the tag end of the line and feed it down between the two lines. Be sure you do this in front of the first twist you made. When the line is fed, go ahead and do the same thing at the other end, but this time you will be twisting the line in the opposite direction, while you guide the tag end upward into the center loop you have created. Slowly, you will pull the lines in opposite direction. Careful to do so at the same time until your knot is good and tight. Finally, once you're sure that knot is good, clip the tag ends very closely. The next couple of knots, the clinch knot and the improved clinch knot, are very popular for their use in attaching tippets to the fly lines. Beyond this function, they are also considered two of the easier knots to tie and are thus perfect for beginning fly tiers. Now, the clinch knot is preferred when you are using smaller flies, particularly size 18 or smaller. In these cases, a light tippet will be the preferred choice. Let's run through the steps of this fairly simple knot right now. Start by feeding the tag end of your line through the eye of the hook, being sure to leave about 3 inches of tag beyond the eye. Go ahead and wrap the tag end 7 or 8 times around the line in the direction of your leader. Next, you will want to run the tag end through the first loop in the line. Be sure that this is just above the hook eye. At this stage, you'll want to moisten the knot area in some way. Many fly tiers use their own saliva to accomplish this, or if they're out around the water, they will take a few drops and apply it to the knot area. After the area is sufficiently moistened, pull the tag end and the line leading to your rod simultaneously. This action will force the coils and the lines to form a tight spiral. After you have them tight, you will slide the tightened coils up against the eye of the hook. Be sure that these coils are all about the same in size and shape, and they do not overlap at all. Finally, finish by clipping your tag end. For bigger flies, you'll want to use the improved clinch knot to apply the light tippets. Nearly identical to the standard clinch knot, the improved clinch knot adds a step to the process. Take the tag end and pass it through the eye of your hook, allowing at least 3 inches of tag beyond the eye. Wrap the tag end 6 or 7 times around the line toward your leader. Next, run the tag end through the first loop above the eye, then over the coils and through the large loop you just created. Moisten the knot area with either saliva or with water from the stream. Grab the tag end and the line going to your rod and pull simultaneously. forcing the coils to form a tight spiral. Once tight, slide the tightened coils against the eye of the hook with your fingernail and assure the coils are in a uniform spiral, not overlapping each other. Then you will finish by trimming the tag end of the line. From the clinch knots, we will move on to a more specialized knot and one that is more complicated than the previous ones. Used to connect the fly line to the backing, which in turn connects with reel, the nail knot is probably one of the strongest connecting knots. It's more complicated simply because you need an accessory tool in order to tie it. It usually takes the form of a small tube or nail. We can see how the knot comes together. The first step will be to place the nail or tube parallel with the end of your fly line. Next, take a leader and lay it beside the fly line. Be sure to leave at least 10 inches of leader line beyond the nail. Then you will want to take hold of all three materials with your left thumb and forefinger on the left edge of the nail. At the same time, with your right hand, grab the end of the leader material. Once you have a firm grip, start wrapping, working the material left to right around everything at least 8 times. Be sure each wrap is close. After you've completed wrapping, you will take hold of what's left of the tag on your leader and push it along the main surface or through the tube. Once everything is secured and the coils are snug, go ahead and remove the nail or tube. Finally, grab both ends of your leader and pull them at the same time until you have a tightly seated knot on the fly line. Then you will tidy it up by clipping the tag end of the leader. Although there are plenty of other knots to examine, it would take another book to examine them each at length. The purpose of this last section was to give you some clear-cut practical information that will get you out there fishing and tying your own beginner knots sooner rather than later. Before we move on, there are some last-minute pointers to mention when it comes to tying your own flies. To avoid making a bad knot, do not rush tying. Tie with care, and your knots will not snag or slip. Match knots with materials. Various knots will work better with some modern materials than with others. Finding the right knots that suit the materials you are using will be a matter of trial and error at first, but you'll get better with time and practice. Moisten or lubricate knots. No matter what kind of a knot you're using, it's a good idea to moisten or lubricate knots in nylon before tightening them. By doing this, you reduce friction that creates heat and can do damage to the nylon. This will in turn be helpful in keeping kinks and tangles from forming in the material. Remember to trim knots. Almost all knots should be trimmed so that there is no more than 1/4 inch or so of line or nylon sticking out from the knot. Test your knots. One should spend enough time practicing tying new knots before tying them under pressure, such as trying to change a fly as the light is fading and fish are rising furiously. Be sure each knot is adequately tested before you use it in action.